Well, good morning. Just as we have heard instrumentally, we have come into his house and gathered in his name to what? To worship him, Christ our Lord. And that is what we have come to do this morning. We have come to worship him. Now, before we begin our time of worship and continue in that, a couple of announcements that we want to make known to you. You've seen some of them scrolling on the screen. First, it is that time of year where the annual giving statements go out. And so, how you can help us help you is to make sure that we have your accurate email address and your accurate mailing address as well. If anything's changed, please just call the church office or email us, and we'll be glad to take care of that as well. Another reminder is, tonight we gather for Sunday school at 6 p.m. We're starting a new series, Dust to Glory, and by R.C. Sproul, it's an overview of Scripture. And so we encourage you to gather with your Sunday school class tonight and study about God's Word and study God's Word tonight. If you don't have a Sunday school class, please see one of the pastors or see someone. We'll be glad to help you get to a Sunday school class. There's nothing like gathering with your Sunday school class. There's a great time of discipleship and fellowship that takes place in those small group times. Well, as I said, we have gathered in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to worship and magnify his name. So let's stand as we are called to worship from his holy word. And let us hear what the prophet Isaiah says in chapter 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. This morning we come to worship a God who reigns, who is sovereign over everything, even bad circumstances and good circumstances as well. He is the one who gives to us liberty, who gives to us comfort when we mourn. He is the one who gives us the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit. And he does so because he reigns. He does so for his glory and for our good. So let us sing together, let us pray together, let us worship together as we hear God's word proclaimed this morning from Psalm 93. Let's join our voices together.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, Jesus, it is he. Lord Sabaoth, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. And though this world with devils filled should threaten,
Let us pray. Holy Father, we've gathered this morning to worship you, for you and you alone are worthy of our worship, of our praise. Father, you spoke and the heavens were created. You created us for your glory. Father, open our hearts, open our minds this morning that we might see you a little more clearly. Father, we praise you for your mercy, for your grace, for your justice, for your kindness, your love. We praise you, Father, for doing for us what we could not do for ourselves and sending Christ to take our place upon the cross. Father, everywhere we look, the world is in chaos. We are thankful that you are in control, that you are sovereign, and that your will be done. Father, we pray that as we continue this morning in worship, that you'll teach us to cast our gaze upon you and only glance at our circumstances. Father, help us to love you more. And as we go out, may we be a light to those that we come in contact with of who you are for your glory. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Will you stand with me this morning for the hearing of God's word? Oh, come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Let us shout joyfully to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods, in whose hands are the depths of the earth. The peaks of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for it was he who made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Today, if you would hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as at Meribah, as in the day of Massa in the wilderness, when your fathers tested me, they tried me, though they had seen my work. For 40 years I loathed that generation and said, they are a people who err in their heart, and they do not know my ways. Therefore I swore in my anger, truly they shall not enter into my rest. This is the word of our Lord from Psalm 95.
O Lord of my heart, not be all else to me save that thou art. Thou my best thought by day or by night, waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wisdom and thou my true word. I ever with thee and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, riches I heed not, or steady anchor in the fury of the storm. When the winds of doubt blow through me and my sails have all been torn, in the suffering, in the sorrow, when my sinking hopes are few, I will hold fast to the anchor. It shall never be removed. Christ, the sure and steady anchor, while the tempest rages on, when temptation claims the battle and it seems the night has won, deeper still then goes the anchor. Though I justly stand accused, I will hold fast to the anchor. It shall never be removed. Christ, the sure and steady anchor, through the flood of unbelief, hopeless somehow, oh my soul, now lift your eyes to Calvary. This my ballast of assurance, see His love forever proved. All my hope is in the anchor. It shall never be removed. Christ, the sure and steady anchor, as we face the wave of death, when these trials give way to glory, as we draw our final breath, we will cross that great horizon, clouds behind and life secure, and the calm will be the better for the storms that we endure. Christ, the shore to the anchor, it shall never be removed.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. May you be seated as we meditate upon the holy word of God.
This past week, on Monday, I got a text from Pastor Todd, and he said that he had tested positive for COVID. So I texted him back immediately, and I said, well, the other pastors have been exposed, so does that mean that Pastor Emeritus gets to preach. Which he texts back and said, well, Mike's already claimed that and he's on standby. I said, okay, I was only half kidding anyway, but I wasn't kidding. But he called me back later that day and he said, well, Chloe had to come home from school, so everything's going on. So maybe you need to just go ahead and plan to preach so we don't have to call you at Saturday morning and say, can you do it? So we did that. So here you are, stuck with the old man today to bring the word. And it's an honor to be able to do that. The last two Sundays I preached to the Crossroads Baptist Church in Berkeley, California, because a friend of mine who's their interim had COVID, so he asked me to preach for him. And it was a great experience. The Crossroads Baptist Church in Berkeley, California is a English-speaking Chinese congregation. And they speak English better than I do, just for the record. And Retta asked me as we started to do it before I did the first Sunday, she said, will they be able to understand your Southern? And I said, well, I don't know if they will or not, but we'll give it a try. But they seemed to understand it okay, and it was a joy. So here's 3 weeks in a row I'm able to bring the word, and that's a great honor and a great joy for me to do. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Psalm 93. Psalm 93 is a psalm that we have looked at a couple of times I know of over the past 15 years or so as we've had been Grace Baptist Church. It was actually the text that I preached for my first sermon I ever preached in Somerset, Kentucky as a pastor. But it's a passage that I think is very applicable and very important for us today. Now, I want to say this up front. I'm preaching this because I think you need to hear it. But more than that, I'm preaching this because I know that I need to hear it. In the circumstances we find ourselves in today and across the country and across the world, it just seems like we need to get our focus right. I love that Pastor Ricky prayed, help us keep our gaze on you and our glance on the circumstances, because that's exactly what we want to talk about today. The concept that our God reigns. And that's how the psalmist begins the psalm. Psalm 93 is a psalm that is the shortest of all the psalms that declare the reign of God, but perhaps it's the most poignant. As a matter of fact, it's in a group of psalms, Psalm 93 and then 95 through 99 particularly are psalms that were sung or were proclaimed and read in the new year in the temple as the Jewish people would come together to worship, preparing to look forward to a new year, knowing that they had enemies out there, knowing that they had struggles out there, knowing that famine might be out there, any number of things. And so every year, at the beginning of the year, they would go to these psalms, and I had Pastor Ricky read the Psalm 95, which is a part of that. They would come together, they would focus on worship, and they would focus on the proper focus for the coming year. Hear the word of the Lord from Psalm 93. The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Yes, the world is established. It shall not be moved. Your throne is established from old. You are from everlasting. The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their roaring. Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Your decrees are very trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. This psalm in the original text of the Hebrew does not have a title. Many of the psalms will have a title above them. This one does not. But the first three words of the psalm really make up what is the title for this and this whole section. The Lord reigns. The Lord reigns. The psalmist is wanting the people to see that no matter what they see around them, no matter how chaotic things might be, God is on his throne and God is reigning. He is not affected by that. We'll get to that in a minute as we talk about the word a little bit that the psalmist talks about. But he wants us to see that this is what needs to be proclaimed. As a matter of fact, those three words, the Lord reigns, is the kind of proclamation which God's people are called to proclaim before all men, everywhere. We talk about evangelism, we talk about missions, and all those are important. They are important. Proclaiming that Christ is Lord, sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ is at the very heart of what we do. But at the very heart of the truth of the gospel is those three words: the Lord reigns. Without that understanding, without that concept, without that reality, we need to understand the gospel has no power and has no message. And so the psalmist says, here's what you are to proclaim. Here's where you are to go. Proclaim that the Lord reigns, no matter how chaotic things appear to be around you. No matter if there's riots in the streets and they're storming the Capitol building and there's accusations of election fraud and there's COVID all over the place, no matter how things look out of control and chaotic, you need to understand that our God reigns. Our God is not affected by that. Our God is not caught by surprise by that. And it has not fallen out from under the reign of the living God. This is something that we must proclaim. James Mays, in his commentary, said this. He said, the declaration Yahweh Malak, which is the Hebrew, the Lord reigns, Yahweh Malak, involves a vision of reality, and it forms the theological center of the entire Psalter. In other words, he's saying we need to understand this. When the psalmist says the Lord reigns, Yahweh Malak, he's saying, I want you to have a vision of reality. Now, we look around us, we say, but this is real. COVID is real, and riots are real, and the stock market, that's real. All these things we see are real. But the psalmist wants to understand that, no, those are illusions. Those are things of the earth that are all under the authority and all under the reign and all under the power of the living God. The Lord reigns. That's our message. When you're talking to friends and when you're talking to family and when you're talking about the chaos and they're bemoaning and crying and fearful and worried, your word to them is, or should be, if you're a believer, the Lord reigns. In the midst of all this, don't think that he's powerless. Don't think that he's not working. Don't think that he's not controlling. Don't think that he's not even using what's going on in the world, because he absolutely is. The Lord reigns. Now, in these first two verses, the psalmist is really laying out several things about the nature of his reign. He starts out by saying, the Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. He is robed in majesty. That has to do with his dignity, his authority, his sovereign power, his stateliness, and his grandeur. Have you ever watched a monarch, some kind of official ceremony, or some kind of, even some of the royal weddings that took place in England that were broadcast across the world? Have you ever paid attention when the monarch comes out, when Queen Elizabeth strolls out on the balcony or wherever she is? She comes out dressed in the most regal garments. She has a long robe that's flowing behind her. She has the crown jewels on. She has the crown upon her head and the scepter in her hand. She's coming out, and she presents to the world sitting there and watching this that I am the king, the queen. I am the one who reigns. I have power and I have authority. And without having to say a word, she's really saying, and I want you to understand, I am the queen, I am the monarch, and you're not. I am the one who is sitting here in the seat on the throne of authority, and you're not. In essence, saying, I really am more important than you are. I would never say that. I don't think the queen would. But I think that she knows that that's exactly what is being portrayed. And that is symbolic of power. Now, if you understand 21st century politics, you realize that the queen really has very little power in England. They have the parliament. They have the two houses of parliament. They have the prime minister and all the others. They have the real power. The queen is a symbolic person of power. She has to approve a few things here and there, but for the most part, she is not the power. The other government leaders are the power. But when you see her, she is robed in a majestic garment with all those jewels that say to the world, I am queen. Bow before me. The problem is, hers is all symbolic. What the psalmist is saying here is that there is no symbolism in the majesty of God. There's no symbolism in his monarchy. Earthly monarchs go to great lengths to portray that. God is that. Isaiah saw that in Isaiah 6. Do you remember the vision in Isaiah 6? When King Uriah died and Isaiah went to the temple immediately to worship. And when he got there, the thresholds were trembling and smoke was filling the temple. And he looked and he saw a vision of God. He saw God high and exalted and on his throne. And he said the train of his robe filled the temple. And smoke filled the temple. And there were angels, seraphim, that were all around the throne of God. They were encircling the throne of God, flying around the throne of God. And they were saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his glory." They were acknowledging the majesty and the glory of God. And his majesty is not a symbolic majesty, the psalmist says. We need to understand that his majesty is a real majesty. It is a reality. It is, as Mays said, it is the vision of reality. And quite honestly, that is the foundation of worldview formation. When we talk about what kind of worldview do we have, and we talk about a Christian worldview or a biblical worldview, you have to understand that the foundation of worldview formation is the fact that God reigns, the sovereignty of God, the power of God, the majesty of God. That is the foundation of any worldview you have. If you see God as strong but not ultimate, your worldview will be faulty. If you see God as someone who's doing the best he can and hoping to get everything done that he can, but we're certainly thwarting what he wants to do, then you have a faulty worldview. The psalmist says, "I want you to see God high and exalted. I want you to see the majesty of God in his reality." Second thing he talks about is the power of God. He says the Lord is majestic. He's robed in majesty. He's robed, but he has put on strength as his belt. Again, that just carries on the thought that his power, his majesty, is not a mere show. It's not a mere symbol. But his majesty is real. And no matter how much monarchs on the earth may try to portray it, they can never reach, can never have the majesty that's wrapped up in God. He is a powerful God. Going out, the scripture says, accomplishing what he desires, carrying out his will to the uttermost parts of the earth. And nothing and no one can hinder that or thwart that. He goes on to say, not only is his strength, his belt, but says, yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Now, some people have looked at that and said, well, that's talking about the world. That's talking about the earth. That's not talking about God. No, it's still talking about God. The earth is established because he is established, and he has established it. The earth is established and will never be moved until he, the sovereign king, says it can be moved or destroyed or ended or whatever. He is in control of all these things. And so the psalmist says that the earth is established. You don't have to worry about it slipping away. You don't have to worry about it sliding out of his control. It will be established until he brings an end to it. Don't worry about it coming to an end. Don't worry about chaos bringing things to an end. He says in verse 2, he says, your throne is established from old, and you are from everlasting. Not only is he a majestic God, not only is he a powerful God, but the psalmist says there, he is an unchanging God. The theological term is the immutability of God, the unchangeableness of God. And what the author means here is that God is established. Your throne is established from old, and because your throne is established from old, the world is established as long as you are on your throne, and you never abdicate that throne, O Lord. So it talks about his immutability. One of the main characteristics that separates God from his creatures, that separates God from you and me, is that we are changeable. We are fickle. We go with the wind. We like this one day. We like that the other day. There are very few things that are absolutely constant in your life or my life. Even we age and we change. I'm looking at my 70th birthday in just a few days, and I just want to tell you, I'm a lot different than I was when I was 54 when I moved to Somerset. Things have changed drastically, physically. They've changed drastically emotionally. in some ways. We are a changing people. God does not change. We can be sure, we can be secure in that fact. And that's one of the applications we'll make of that in a minute. Your throne is established. You're majestic, you're powerful, you're immutable, and you're eternal. These verses, these first two verses talk about the eternality or the aseity of God, the isness of God. When it says, your throne is established from old, you are from everlasting. What the psalmist is saying is, Lord, you are the God who is, who has always been, and who will always be. There is no changing in you, and there is no ending with you, because there was no beginning with you. Many of you have heard me tell the story about my first pastor out of seminary. In Alexander City, Alabama, I went and was preaching there, and after a month or two, I was walking around on Sunday morning, and I was listening in on some of the classes, happened to be in the children's area on this particular Sunday, and there was a third or fourth grade class there, and I didn't go in, I stood outside the door, and I listened to the teacher teaching. And the teacher said this, she said to the class, she said, tell me, children, who made God? I thought, well, that's a wise teacher. She's going to get into the eternality of God here and everything. And little Johnny, whoever little Johnny was, spoke up and raised his hand and said, I know. And she said, well, who made God, Johnny? She said, God made God. And I thought, boy, it's a great teachable moment. And she said, that's right, Johnny, God made God. And I flipped out right there in the hallway. Well, need to say, I had a discussion with that teacher that next week. And we kind of straightened some things out because God didn't create God. For God to have created God, for God to have made God, God would have had to have been God and not been God at the same time. He would have had to not be God so God could make himself, and it had to have been God so he could have made God. You see the reality of that foolishness? No, the psalmist says, you are from everlasting. You are the God who is, who has been, and who always will be. The aseity of God, the isness of God. Not the wasness, not the to-be-ness, but the isness of God is the reality. Back just three psalms, the psalmist says in Psalm 90, verses 1 and 2, he said, Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. You've been our dwelling, in other words, from Adam and Eve, all the way up to where we are now, and really all the way to the end of time, you have been our dwelling place for all generations. And then he says, before the mountains were born, or you gave birth to the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. Oh, what a glorious truth. That God did not just come into existence at some point. God does not just happen. But God has always been. He is eternal. And Revelation, the book of Revelation, that great vision of John, John says in that God says, Jesus says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. That doesn't mean he had a beginning, he has an ending. It just means the way our finite minds work, you need to understand that what we would think of as a beginning, God was there. And what we think of as an ending, God will be there, because God has always been and always will be. So we face chaos. We face a world of chaos. We face a world where there are fears and struggles and worries, knowing that that's who he is. Now, the nature of his reign, majestic, powerful, immutable, unchangeable, and eternal, means two things for you and me. Two great applications. One, he can be trusted to remain as he has revealed himself to be. Let that sink in. He can be trusted to remain as he reveals himself to be in his word. Can't be trusted to be what you think you want him to be or what you think he ought to be, but he can be trusted to be who he reveals himself to be. He will be at the end of our days exactly as he was at the beginning. He will be at the end of our Christian life when we die and go into his presence just as he was at the beginning of our Christian life. We don't have to worry that somewhere along the way he's going to change the standards. He's going to change the rules. He's going to say, well, that's not good enough anymore. You got to do this or this. No, God does not change. That brings great comfort to a believer. Because listen, as I said, we're fickle. We struggle. We sometimes do dumb things. We sin. And in our way of thinking, why would God not just say, okay, you sinned, you're out of here, I want nothing to do with you? No, because His promises are secure. Because He is who He says He is, and He is like He says He is, and He will do what He says He will do. Second application, or second thing this means to us is this. God is inescapable. He's inescapable. We may try to ignore Him. We may try to hide our sin from Him. We may try to run and get in a corner and do some things we know that are displeasing to Him. But the reality is, God is totally and completely inescapable. Remember how David put it in Psalm 139 when he said, even if I go to the highest mountain, you're there. Even if I go to the depths of the sea, you're there. If I even go into the realm of the dead and to Sheol, Lord, you're there also. There's nowhere that I can go to escape your presence. Now again, for a believer, that ought to bring great comfort. That I cannot run out of the presence of God. That I cannot run and escape from His watchful eye, His caring eye, His loving eye. But it also ought to bring us to a point of realizing, but that watching eye, that caring eye, will not let us wander and squander in sin either. It will call us out and call us to repentance. The reign of our sovereign God is perfect, the psalmist wants us to see in verses 1 and 2. But what about the world? Well, he uses some pretty powerful language in verses 3 and 4 where he talks about the world's chaos. And what I want us to think about today is trusting God, this God that's revealed in verses 1 and 2, trusting that God, that true God, that living God, in the midst of chaos. Because we live in chaos today. At best, we live in chaos. And he says here, you know, the floods have lifted up, O Lord, the floods have lifted up their voice, the floods lift up their roaring. Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty. Now, he uses nature here to kind of talk about the chaos in the world. But what I want you to see is, in our way of thinking in 2021, coming out of 2020, we have this idea that, man, things are chaotic today, and they've never been this way before. I want you to see that the psalmist in Psalm 93 is saying, this is pre-Christ. This is B.C. This is thousands of years ago, and the world is a chaotic place. Whether it be natural disasters or man-made disasters, those things are happening. And God's people need not fear. They need not worry. The world is in disarray. It has been since the fall. It has been since shortly after the creation when Adam and Eve chose to sin and disobey God and sin entered into the world. The world became chaotic at that moment. Chaos entered in. And when you look at the history of Israel, if you think that things are bad today, go back and look at the history of Israel. How many good kings did they have to lead them? They had a few. But they were few and far between. Most of the kings gave into idolatry. Most of the kings gave into immorality. Most of the kings fell and led the nation into rampant sin. They had very few good kings. Chaos reigned. They had nations that wanted to destroy them. We say, well, today we got Russia meddling and we got China meddling and they want to destroy us. So what's new? They say, yeah, but today we've got COVID and we've got all, yeah, they had leprosy. So what's new? I mean, the truth of the matter is the world since the fall has been in utter chaos, and the only constant, the only thing that remains firm, the only thing that remains true is that our God reigns. The Lord reigns. He's seated on His throne. So the psalmist says, listen, the world is a mess. And the world is a mess because of the fall. But God rules even over the forces of nature and especially over the forces of men. That's what he's saying here. That's what he's making clear here. He said, oh, at times my people flounder. And let me just say, the church in America has floundered. The Church in America is weak. Church in America is sold out to prosperity gospel in many cases. They're sold out to compromise in many cases. They're not standing true with the Word. They're not standing true on truth. We're just as bad as Israel was when they turned to idols. We turn to idols. And I say we, because like I said at the beginning, I think you need to hear this sermon. I know I need to hear it. But our God reigns. And we have to realize that many times the raging waters and the raging seas, they're still under his control. Whether they're natural disaster or human-made disasters like politics are sometimes used for God's judgment of a people. God is not always sending stuff just for our good. Many times he sends it for our judgment. Somebody said to me a couple of weeks ago, said, oh, I don't know what we're going to do. I don't know what's going to happen to the church if America falls. Because I really think America is at the verge of falling, to be honest with you. But I want you to understand something. If it falls, it doesn't affect God one bit. If it falls, it may make things more difficult for the church, but it won't affect the church one iota. If America falls, and there is no America like we have known and I've known for my 70 years, if it falls, God still reigns. And it will not change one bit. The church may have to do new methods. The church may have to kind of gather together quietly. The church may have to do a lot of things. But the church, the true church, the real believers, the real body of Christ will not be affected one iota. Because of the songs we've sung today that point to that great truth. Well, we see the reign of our sovereign God. We see the world's chaos. But then he comes back in verse 5 and he says, I want you to see God's rule is certain and sure. God's rule is certain and sure, even in the midst of chaos. It says, your decrees. And that word decrees there, you can take other words and put it, you can put in there your laws, your truths, your word, your commandments, your rule, whatever you want to put there. His decrees are his proclamations. And he says, your decrees are very trustworthy. They're not just trustworthy, they're very trustworthy. They are absolutely trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore. Number one is the rule of his word is certain and sure. Think about Psalm 19. You don't have to turn there, but you'll remember this. In the second half of that psalm, the psalmist David says, the law of the Lord is perfect. Law could be word. The word of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The testimony of the Lord, the testimony could be the word of the Lord. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure. The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The rules of the Lord are true and altogether righteous. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter are they than honey and the drippings of the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is your servant warned, and in keeping them, there's great reward. David says, listen. He says in Psalm 93, he says in Psalm 19, God's word will rule, and God's rule will be sure and secure. It'll be a sure and steady anchor, as we sang a bit ago. It will not fail. Or as Paul told young Timothy in 1 Timothy 3:15, he said, listen, the church is to be the pillar and support of the truth. Jesus said in John 17:17, your word, O Lord, your word, Father, is truth. And by it we are sanctified. By it we are made holy. And so the psalmist is just simply expressing here that in the midst of absolute chaos, in the midst of absolute uncertainty, in the midst of circumstances that we certainly would not choose to be in the middle of, we find ourselves in the middle of it, and our only hope, our only security, our only goodness comes from focusing upon and trusting in the God who never changes and the God who reigns. That's the clarity of God's Word. I saw something a few weeks ago, and I love it, and I believe it with all my heart. It said, you know, we live in a day where a lot of people are disagreeing with the Word of God, with the Scriptures. And I'm not even talking about outside the church. I'm talking about people who call themselves churches. And they say, well, this is not up to date. This is really not in line with the culture. This is not in line with the thinking of the day. It's on the wrong side of history, or whatever, however you want to say it. It's an old book. It really needs to be updated. And it's being said over and over again. And outside the body of Christ, outside the church, I mean, it's rampant. What? The Bible? Why do you tell me anything about the Bible? The Bible's an old book, has nothing to do with today. How wrong they are. You can disagree with the Bible all you want, and you have the right to do that. Did you know that? You have the freedom to disagree with the Bible. You can say, I don't like that part, I don't want that part. You have the right to do that. But let me tell you something. Disagree with the Bible all you want. The Bible is still right, and you're still wrong. No matter where it is. No, by the way, it's the littlest sin that you would seek to excuse or the biggest abomination to God that you can think about. The Bible's right. You are wrong if you disagree with it. Spurgeon made this statement in one of his sermons. He said, then some will ask me, tell us how to discern the truth. If the Word is true, how do we know the truth? Spurgeon said, you may judge truth by three things: by God, by Christ, and by man. He said, that is, the truth which honors God, the truth which glorifies Christ, and the truth which humbles man. If it doesn't honor God, glorify Christ, and humble man, then it is not truth. It is a lie seeking to be man-centered, to exalt man and lower God, making us big, God small. It ceases to be truth. Spurgeon went on to say, unless a doctrine exalts God, unless it owns Him as monarch of all creation and gives Him the absolute power over His creatures, that's you and me, He the potter and ourselves the clay, He molding the vessels as seems good in His sight, we as the vessels that are molded after His pleasure, God everything and ourselves nothing, that doctrine, if it does not teach that, is not truth. Goes on to talk about the doctrine of atonement that seeks to raise man up to save himself. He said, if a doctrine teaches that man is possessed of good natural powers, that he is not so fallen as the Bible states, that he can do somewhat to help himself, that his exertions can meet with God's grace halfway, and that he can assist a little in the work of salvation, or at any rate that he can preserve himself from falling away and holding his own with steadfastness, it is man-glorifying, God-dishonoring doctrine. Cast it to the winds, for it never came from above. God never intended it to be preached otherwise than as the very foil of blackness against the brightness of His own truth. I wish Bill Haynes had said that. That's what Spurgeon said. And he said it so right. The rule of His Word. That's why the Word is important in the life of the believer. That's why I'm meditating on the Word. I love one of the innovations that the pastors have done since my retirement is that scripture meditation just before the sermon. I love that. And to just think about the Word, just dwell upon the Word. Today it was Psalm 46, the first three verses, which are the verses which Luther based "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God," our first hymn, upon this morning. You know, God is our fortress. And His Word is what we stand with. Then, not only that, the psalmist talks about the rule of His character. There's the rule of His Word, and there's the rule of His character. It's quite simple. Your decrees, Your Word, are very trustworthy. They're right, you're wrong, if you disagree. Okay, we got that. Holiness befits Your house, O Lord, forevermore. Holiness befits Your house forevermore. Everything in Scripture that is associated with God is holy. And so it follows that we must be holy too. Now, I look at myself and I think, I don't think of myself a lot of times as really that holy. I'm self-centered. I'm not looking out just for the glory of God. I'm looking out for the desires of Bill. I don't feel that holy. What does it mean that holiness befits your house? Recognizing that the house of God is not this building. The house of God is God's people. Well, just as in the vessels in the temple were made holy by being set apart for use for God only, so you and I are the vessels in the new temple that are being set apart for God's use only, for God's use ultimately. And we're set apart by Him to be holy in His presence, be holy in His sight. Peter talked about that in 1 Peter 2. He talked about the church. He said, but you, very emphatic you, not you, everybody in the world, but you who are a part of the body, you who are part of the church, but you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. That's where our primary citizenship is. It's not in the United States. Yes, I'm a United States citizen. I'm happy to be a United States citizen, but my ultimate citizenship is in heaven. My ultimate citizenship is in the nation which is the kingdom of God. A holy nation. A people for God's own possession. For God to own and for God to use and to God to possess. That you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. The darkness of sin and death into the light of His glory. Holy nation, chosen people, chosen race, royal priesthood, people for God's own possession. Holiness befits His household. Now, you and I both know that He is holy in absoluteness. You and I are holy at best in finiteness. But we're holy not because of what we can do. We're holy because of who we are in Him. That union with Christ, that being in Christ and Him in us, that brings the holiness of His possession of us that begins to work out the holiness in our life. It's what Paul meant to the Philippian Christians when he said, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. He didn't mean you work and you earn your salvation. He means that which God has put in you, you begin to work out by the Holy Spirit's work in your life, by the Word of God. Work it out so others see what is in. And that which is in is holiness. We are called for holiness. The writer of Hebrews said, pursue peace with all men. And the sanctification or the holiness without which no one will see the Lord. Yes, pursue peace with all men, but be sure you understand that peace with all men will only be affected really in the sanctification process as we're both growing more holy in our walk with Christ. The psalmist says holiness befits the house of God. Our culture many times doesn't believe the church because it doesn't see holiness. It sees materialism. It sees everything the culture wants, we want. It seeks self-glorification. It seeks self-importance. Folks, I began this sermon by saying the proclamation that is to be the proclamation of the Church of Jesus Christ is the Lord reigns. Not that Grace Baptist reigns or a pastor reigns or anything like that. Nothing of that is true. The Lord reigns. Not even that the Christian church reigns. God reigns. The Lord reigns. And when we put our eyes on riots in the street and the storming of the Capitol and the Electoral College and we put our hope in all those kind of things of being a Democrat or being a Republican or getting sick of both and saying, I'm just an independent, so I'm proudly an independent. If we put our hope in any of that stuff, we have failed to see what our calling is. Our calling is to say, we gaze upon the glory of God. we gaze upon the truths and the beauty of His glorious holiness. And as we gaze upon that and hear from Him in His Word, we listen. We listen from His Word. As the old preacher said one time, if you really want to hear the voice of God, read the Bible. If you want to hear the voice of God loudly, read it loudly. I mean, the truth is, that's His Word to us. That's His truth to us. And we as Christians, and listen, I'm beating myself up on this one. We need to pay less attention to what's going on around us and more attention to Him. Seeking His face. Seeking to know His presence in a glorious way every single day. Yeah. He can be trusted. He is inescapable. Either for judgment or for glory. Look to Him in the most difficult times of trouble. And look to Him in the most joyous days you experience, because both are under His control completely. Pray with me, would you? Father, we know this. Help us know it. We know this. Help us live it. We know that You reign. Help us live. Help me live like You reign. Father, be glorified in Your people. Be glorified in Your church, at Grace and beyond. Show Yourself to us in power in the midst of chaos. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I hope you noticed the songs today. A mighty fortress is our God. Christ, the sure and steady anchor. The Lord, our strength and song. Be Thou my vision. You know, that's a prayer. Be Thou my vision is a prayer. Lord, You be my vision. Help me see rightly that You are in control. And now Psalm 62, I'll not be shaken. I'll not be shaken not because I'm strong, but I'll not be shaken because He is strong. And He is in me, and He is my Lord. Sing this with that assurance this morning if you are in Christ. And if you're not in Christ, I invite you to come to Christ. Especially you watching online. Trust Christ today. He is the only sure and steady anchor. Call the church. One of the pastors would love to talk to you about your relationship to Christ. Stand with me as we sing together. Thank you.
your hope in gain of riches. Seek not your rest in empty wealth. The rich are weak, the poor are mighty, who turn to God alone. For all my hope is in His love. From God alone comes my salvation. I wait and trust His steadfast in Him to hear you cry. No other hope will never fail you. No other love will not run dry. I'll not be shaken. I'll not be shaken. For all my
shaken because of His steadfast love, because of His power, because of His unchangeableness, because of His majesty. He reigns, and I am His subject under His authority. Hear the word of the Lord. It's benediction this morning from Jude's little epistle. Fits right in with, you would think Jude probably had read Psalm 93 several times, and he had. Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of His glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you. Go in His word and go in peace.